So careful. This can only be expected if, I want to mention three things here. If, firstly, the hardships don't always inflict the same people or groups of people, that should be ruled out. Secondly, if their respective losers in society are cushioned and reintegrated as quickly as possible. And thirdly, if all young people receive an equal opportunity to participate in the sex and the success of the systems by giving the relevant training education, it cannot be denied that there's still a great deal to do here at both the national and international levels. And the fact that something needs to be done can be justified very well in ethical terms, but also in economic terms. And here is a question of these things, two things running in parallel. There could be interaction between these two categories, ethical and economic. Perhaps I could formulate it as follows. People have a right to the development of their skills and abilities. In 1968 and afterwards, people said there was a right to education. That's the ethical interpretation, or to come on to economic interpretation now. Otherwise, potential goes to waste that contribute a great deal to the benefit of the public at large. So these are just two sides of the same coin. Those who are poor, who have failed, are generally regarded as cost factors. We, however, should regard them as being assets that need to be developed. That's essential from an ethical point of view. And in economical terms, economic terms, they represent a good investment. So people as assets, that's a fundamental aspect of good corporate governance, particularly in challenging forms of production. The success of company depends increasingly on whether the company management succeeds in motivating their staff, in developing them into committed, independently thinking members of the company. They must be treated with respect if that's to be achieved. Their dignity must be recognized, and they must feel that they enjoy recognition as moral subjects, not just as elements in a production procedure. Value added by being valued is the motto here. And this is required equally by ethics and by economics. We should not play off the one against the other. And all good ethics has an economic foundation, and good economics has an ethical and moral purpose. So you can follow this back on into the classical works. One of my pupils in England has written a book. This is an academic book. Went on hotcakes. And decided, but is God an economist? What does he do? He's doing an economic, he made interpretation along economic lines of the Old Testament. Worked out very, very well for him. Another of my students, Christoph Lütke, formulated things at his university lecture here. We must avoid at all costs that we do away with the foundation of our economy, morality, and then it will fall apart if we do so very, very quickly. Was that it then?
Well,
you may well know the dictum of the Nobel economics laureate Milton Friedman. It goes back to the 1960s, the social responsibility of business, full stop. And Adam Smith was also interpreted by his critics in such a way that in the free play of market forces, general prosperity is self-regulatory. Now, we know today, so Adam Smith presumes such a set of rules and regulations. Within that set of rules and regulations, prosperity emerges, as it were, as if guided by an unseen hand. So, was Milton Friedman right? We know that the task of companies today are not exhausted in the form of Friedman's business. But the concepts about what needs to be added on, well, they're very varying, contradictory, and unsorted views in that respect. And from my point of view, it's of practical significance to inject a system into this colourful array of ideas that can stand up to some critical questioning. So in the next section, I'd like to look at two extensions of the market economy, just two. And the first of these is the social market economy, and the second is the extension by corporate responsibility, CSR.
First of all, let us look at the social market economy itself and our understanding of this. Public debate shows again and again, even if we look at Germany's Christian Democrat Union parties, for example, if you like, that they are always claiming to be the legitimate heritage of the social market economy, that basically they are saying that the morally acceptable social market economy is only social and therefore only morally acceptable if it is corrected ethically, so that the pursuit of profit cannot take off completely and that those who are impacted negatively on by the market economy are protected. So keeping in check, taming, domesticizing the market. But I find this approach very, very difficult. It has very heavy baggage with it. Because we have to then look at the reversal conclusion if we support this. Namely, we have to say that the market economy is in its very self amoral, unmoral, immoral.
Und wenn man diese Auffassung im Hinterkopf hat, dann läuft
and
die Politik so.
Then the political response would need to be that the extent of morality is identified not in the extent of the market economy itself, but the extent of correction necessary. And then there's no stopping the moral reasons for having even more corrections. More than 50% of our prices are not competitive prices. And this is the result of this approach. Politically, the motto that arises is the more corrections we make, the more moral we are, until we've almost corrected away market economy completely. So what sort of a balance do we require? For myself, for ethical and economic reasons, the attitude remains that the social market economy is the better market economy. We agree on that much. But it must also be the better market economy by developing more and more people into strong market participants and through ensuring a system of social security that we invest more and more in these people, both in terms of fixed and human capital, so that our market economy really gets going, and it's got to really get going for the whole system to work. And perhaps you can make this idea very clear using a comparison that I suppose goes back to the great Austrian economist Schumpeter, who compares the social state with a brake on your car. If you press on the brakes, the car drives more slowly and may even stop.
Aber der Sinn eines guten Bremssystems besteht nicht darin zu stehen, sondern darin, im Normalbetrieb schneller fahren zu können,
but to be able to drive more quickly in normal operation than you could if you didn't have a brake.
So viel zur sozialen, zum Verständnis des sozialen
the social component of social market economy.
Das wird im öffentlichen Diskurs völlig
I think this is something that gets lost in public debate. And I don't think there are any politicians who would divide things up the way I just have.
They
wouldn't differentiate the way I have, and I believe I've differentiated correctly. The theory that the market economy is only morally acceptable if it is corrected is something I have also heard from a renowned Christian Democrat politician, and I respect him very much, but he couldn't help see it that way. Now let us look at the whole question of CSR and the social responsibility of companies. This is something debated heatedly. There are national and international commissions set up to come up with position papers on this, but it's all being done without a sound theoretical background
foundation.
Let me begin thus. In the public debate, we always assume that it's not natural people like you and I who are responsible, but artificial people, i.e. organizations and their prototype, the company.
And now, perhaps,
I can leave the philosophical problems of the concept of responsibility to one side, particularly the responsibility of collectives. Who is responsible for Mr. Siemens? For Siemens, Mr. von Pierre, Mr. Löscher, the second layer of management, the compliance department of the company that ensures that everything is done according to the law. That's several hundred employees in the compliance department. I think 500 to 600, perhaps 900, somebody once told me, if you take it down properly. So who exactly is responsible?
Konzentrieren wir uns
so let us concentrate here
auf die Frage, wofür
on the question of what companies are responsible for and where the limits of their responsibility lie in public debate. Again, the negative image in the market economy. Companies are given their entities that are equipped with a license to earn money, or a license to operate, perhaps. Organizations equipped with privileges. And this is why they have a moral requirement to give society something back.
Wir müssen der Gesellschaft etwas zurückgeben. Das setzt aber voraus, dass sie was bekommen haben, nämlich genau diese Lizenz.
But this assumes that they were given something before they give something back, i.e. this license to earn money. This suggests that it's an absolutist state where the king gives and issues privileges
to earn money.
But if you set up your strategy for the justification of the market economy based on this, I believe you are on the wrong track. I'd like to refer to Franz Böhm now, one of the fathers of our social market economy, who argued against this, saying that companies do not have a license to earn money, but rather that society commissions companies with a job they must deliver, they must do, namely the job to deliver certain services to society, namely good, cheap, innovative products and services efficiently and reliably. That's their mandate. And companies are better equipped to carry this out than anyone else in society. They can do this reliably, efficiently, and companies essentially are there to fulfill a social mandate.
Sagt in seiner
Formulierung, he says, and perhaps in the formulation you can see how hard it is for him to express this idea.
Unternehmen unterliegen
he says that companies are subjected to a social responsibility for taking on the job of delivering these services.
Aber aus dem Kontext ist es völlig klar, dass das meint.
Seen out of context,
Sie haben einen or seen in the context,
you can see that's what he means. It's as if they have a social mandate
that they have to fulfill. Und meint damit nicht etwa die